Do the trick. Okay. Yes. Okay. We're there. Hi, Noel. So nice to meet you.
And
thank you so much for joining us. So at the beginning of the show, I like to start the program every day with something funny because invariably things get serious when we talk about what's going on in the world. And so I open with a comedy bit. And today I played the bit that I saw you do, your stand-up bit from, I think it was February of last year, the first one I saw of you when you started talking about Trump and you talked about his Adderall use, and it exploded. I mean, that thing went viral quickly, didn't it?
It sure did. Yeah, it got like 3 million views, I think, a day after it went viral.
Wow.
And I was just talking about it in nightclubs. You know, I was doing that set for like 50 people probably for a year before it went viral.
Really? It's so funny because it takes one person, I guess, in the audience with a camera, unless you posted it. Actually, I saw it on YouTube. Posted
yeah.
by a law firm who I guess was dealing with NDAs. Is this your law firm?
Yeah, that's John Phillips. He also represents Omarosa. And I was actually speaking with him today. He's interested in the case, you know.
Oh, real? Yeah, so you are the only person that I know of who ever worked with Donald Trump who is not afraid of these non-disclosure agreements. You even said in that bit that you signed, it was like a 28-page NDA?
Yeah, it's a long NDA, and most people didn't speak out. In the 16 election, you know, people were starting to chatter. People in television production were talking on Facebook and stuff about what we'd seen, because I'm not alone. Like, everybody had seen that stuff going back to the beauty pageants, which mm-hmm. I was worked on too. So basically, I told Hillary's campaign, they reached out to me. I told People magazine, I told a bunch of people in 16. They didn't run with it. You know, they figured he wasn't going to win anyway. The Apprentice, you know, or rather the Access Hollywood tape came out, and most people thought, like, that's the end of him.
Right.
So a lot of my colleagues who would have spoken out, once they heard that tape and once they heard Mark Burnett was going to sue everybody who spoke out, they clammed up, which is why I went into stand-up and just started doing it in nightclubs. And you mentioned that thing that went viral. I didn't put it out viral. I was just doing it in nightclubs. I had the video, and I sent it to a friend who's kind of well-known in Canada. He has an improv group called the Trailer Park Boys.
Okay.
And I said, why don't you check this out? Just so you know, because he was interested in Trump. I said, he really is a drug addict. I talk about it in my stand-up. I sent him the video. I said, I don't have Twitter. Let me set up a Twitter account. So I set up a Twitter account. That's the Noel Castler comedy account.
Right.
Went to sleep. Woke up in the morning, and everyone from Kathy Griffin to like Paul McCartney had like seen it and retweeted it. So
wow.
Yeah.
So you've experienced, now two viral explosions
yeah.
in your lifetime. The first one, I'm sure, was more rewarding than this one. So you didn't do comedy before you decided you wanted to spread, to go public about Trump?
Exactly. I'd done comedic acting. I went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts 25 years ago, and I'd done improv at UCB and stuff. And I'd done a lot of stuff behind the scenes. So I'd worked with Seinfeld on the Marriage Ref and, you know, comedy awards, comic relief. So I'd been around comedy, but my gig was always behind the scenes. So I hadn't done stand-up comedy in New York. And that's why I did it, so I could speak out.
Wow. Well, that's incredible.
It was also, you know, it was an artistic thing, because I didn't, you know, I did speak out in 16, but nobody ran with it. They didn't think he was going to win. Then he won, you know, and I sat around like everybody else, kind of pulling my hair out for a year, you know, for those first months of 17. And I knew how dark it was going to get. And I was like, people don't even know who this guy is. And if he was doing drugs and functional, I wouldn't say anything. I used to tour with rock bands. Mm-hmm. 70-year-old drug addicts are like in my job description. You know, if you can go out and play the concert and do your gig, I'm not judging you. What I'm really talking about in his, and he's a daily Adderall addict.
Huh.
You don't have to listen to me. You can look at him sniffing and all
the
stuff.
Oh, absolutely. You can see it.
But the main thing I sort of wanted to warn people about, you know, like the substance is just like a symptom, you know, it's the underlying mental illness of like self-centeredness, resentment, you know, anger, rage, all those issues I've seen in him worse than any addict I've seen. And I have a lot of experience with that stuff, you know, and I'm not trying to denigrate addiction at all. I'm just, it's not who you want in charge. An active drug addict is the last guy you want in charge. And like you said, even take that away, he's already mentally mentally unfit.
That's
He's
right.
He's already imbalanced, right now, as you know.
Now, I saw you wrote something. You know, I've noticed, I've unfortunately seen his face too often that I can't, it's a, you know, can't get it, I can't unsee it. But I have noticed that on the side of his nose, there are these bumps. And I've often wondered what those are. Well, you know what they are. What is it?
That's septoplasty. Those are scars. He had, you know, he blew out his septum snorting cocaine in the 80s and 90s. He's a long-term drug user.
Wow.
You know, Adderall is his maintenance high now, but he's long history of drug use. And there's many others who have the same thing. You get a condition where you basically burn a hole in your septum and they have to go in there and repair it. So that's what those big bumps are in the side of his nose. And makeup wouldn't stick to it on The Apprentice. It was a production issue because it's, you know, the skin is not like the natural skin. I don't know. It's like putty or something.
Like grafted on or something. Wow.
Exactly.
So
you can see it. Yes. Clear as day in any of the pictures.
You can see it. And it's very pronounced, especially on his right side. It's something my eyes keep going to because I'm going, what is that? Is that like an underground zit or something? It's like trying to figure out what, but it doesn't go away. It's been there for these past 4 years.
It's called coke nose in the parlance of drug users, you know?
Wow. So Donald Trump tries to say he's a teetotaler. He doesn't drink. He doesn't do drugs. And you're saying that's bullshit.
It's complete bullshit. And addiction runs in his family. You know, his brother now is an active alcoholic. His older brother died of alcoholism. Mm-hmm. His kids have had their own issues. They were dry for a long time. Ivanka and Don Jr. I don't think Don Jr. looks that sober these days. I don't know if you've seen him recently. But
no, he does not look good. None of them are looking good.
Red and glassy, you know. So addiction is a genetic, you know, however you want to think about it. It's sort of a family disease.
Right.
So he does drink. You know, he's not a drinker. Mm-hmm. His drug of choice is a stimulant because it makes him feel in control. And what I witnessed, you know, the Adderall, he can't read. He's like dyslexic and he never treated that. They were ashamed of it when he was a kid, I believe. So when he had to read cue cards, that was a major trigger for him. You know, that's when he would run off and snort it up because he feels in control. That's why when you see him giving speeches, you know, he's just reading with his fingers.
Yeah.
He's not thinking about what he's saying. He's just trying to get through this hooked on phonics exercise, you know?
Right. I've often said he reminds me of like a second grader who actually didn't write the book report. Maybe he took his older brother's book report and is now reading it for the first time in front of the class. That's what
him.
Trump reminds me of every time he gives a speech.
That's 100% him. That's what it is. So that's why, you know, and the stimulants will make him feel like he's smarter in those instances. And that's why they bought up all his school records. His dad, you know, threatened to sue any university that released his grades, his high school.
Yep.
You know, going back to elementary school, they were covering up for his learning disabilities. And it's a real sore point for him. He would attack like crew members on The Apprentice because he thought they were trying to set him up. If there was a three-syllable word, arbitrage was the first time I saw that happen. Irony, since he's supposed to be this businessman and he can't pronounce arbitrage. You know?
Right. Well, you know, he can't say anonymous either. So there's that.
Anonymous.
Or origins.
He also uses benzodiazepine. That's what you temper. You know, the stimulants, you come down with benzos. So that's why you see that mush mouth. That's from Valium, Xanax.
Yes.
You know?
Wow. So now Noel Castler is with us. Again, he worked on Celebrity Apprentice for how long? Like 6 years?
6 seasons of the finales. I came in and handled like Ivanka for the last 3 seasons. The first few seasons I did like the celebrity talent and the Trump family. That's what I did for 25 years. Anything from the Grammys, you know, the Super Bowl halftime show. If it's live and on TV, I took care of the talent.
You're a talent wrangler. Yeah.
Exactly. That's what I was a talent wrangler. Very, like, it's a very small world. And I kind of like became one of the top guys at that. So it was a nice life for a long time, you know. And that's also when you work in talent, you don't speak out. I worked with Michael Jackson. I've worked with Madonna. Like, I've seen a lot of stuff. I would never even dream of saying anything and never have about anybody else.
I understand because, you know, that's your reputation. You know, you want to be trusted, but this is a different case. So So as you said, in the last few years, you were Ivanka's handler. You were her personal person.
I was her personal guy, because what I was known for was, like, on TV shows, I would get assigned the diva. You know, if it was the host of a show or somebody was worried about, that was who I would get, because the producers had faith in me that I had enough experience that I could handle whatever came up. So she became, like, the most important thing about the show. Right. And by example, she's the only one who got a trailer. She got everybody else was in pipe and drape and stuff. Uh-huh. In the last three seasons, we shot it at the Museum of Natural History in New York.
Really? Wow.
The Lafrak Theater, which is in the basement area.
Gotcha. You know?
So there's an underground parking garage, and she got this triple wide trailer. I mean, ridiculously long. And I got a resentment because everybody else would, say, have a call time at 4 p.m. I would have to show up at noon to let her glam squad into the trailer to prep for her arrival at 6 p.m. or something ridiculous, you know? And
oh my God.
I was mad because I was like, what? And she had a 5-person glam squad. And that was all billed back to the production. That wasn't like, so she's kind of the queen of that. I tell people, like, Donald Trump wants music to play when he walks into a room. He wants to get high and he wants to hit on girls. You know,
right.
He's only concerned with what immediately is going to gratify his ego. Ivanka and Jared, they're a little slicker. They're playing the long game here and they're trying to rule the world, in my opinion. You know, they're the ones I'd fear.
Now, you said that. So you said that they're power hungry. Trump just wants his name in the papers and wants everyone talking about him. He wants idol worship, but they want to run the world.
Exactly. Want to profit from this thing in a big way.
Course.
And it's not that Trump doesn't want to profit, but it's not his, as much as you think he's greedy, he's lost his fortunes many times. You know, he's made enough money that most people would just go sit on an island and count their money. That's not Trump. Like, he likes to break things. You know, he's like that kid. He literally threw rocks at the neighbor's baby when he was a little kid. It's in the Washington Post, you know? So it's like he wants to break stuff. And he's easily manipulatable because of what I said. You know, so say he's an agent of a foreign power and you're trying to take down the U.S., he's the perfect beast, you know, because you can appeal to his sense of narcissism
of
like the Saudis did.
Yep.
You know, his first trip overseas, they had a big golden glow, you know, orb dance. And they put his face up on the side of a building. And all of a sudden, Saudi Arabia is our greatest ally we've ever had.
Yeah. No, it's.
But they're clever. They're behind the scenes and they try to stay out of the fray. And, you know, Ivanka's always trying to kind of like go down the middle and speak really nice, you know, as opposed
but
to
she
her father.
She has that voice. Daddy, she's all breathy. And you're saying that that's not her real voice?
Yeah, you got that, Nicole. That's her. That's made up for her father. You can look up tapes of her speaking as a teenager. She was on Conan O'Brien, different voice. Her real speaking voice is about an octave lower. She sounds like a girl from Queens who curses all the time.
So she does have a potty mouth too? Oh, it's good to know there's something human about
her. She curses like a sailor.
Wow.
That voice is for her dad. It makes her dad feel better. He trained her in that. You know, she knows how to assuage him, like I just described.
Right.
You know, he's easily manipulatable. It's like, Daddy, can I come to the White House with you and run things? You know, can you hire Jared?
Oh, God. It is frightening just looking at the effect that he has on her. So there's something else that you have said in interviews, Noel, that and I'm wondering how you would know this. You said that Donald Trump, in addition to all his other problems, has an incontinence problem, that he wears adult diapers and that he regularly, pardon my French, shits himself, and that they actually called the Celebrity Apprentice the shit show or something like that?
Yep. The shit show was one of the crew nicknames for it. And how I know it is because he would do it on set. And the first time I saw it was that meltdown with Arbitrage. He freaks out. He flies into rages. You've heard about this being leaked a little bit from the White House, but he's a rageful guy behind the scenes. You can see flashes of it when he gives these press conferences. But he would soil himself. Profoundly incontinent because of all the speed and all the fast food. All he eats is McDonald's and meatloaf.
Yeah.
You know? So, but yeah, no, he would soil himself on set. And he's done it as president. I mean, when he visited the CDC in early March, Governor Kemp, one of his aides, tweeted out a picture of Trump. You know, she meant it like, here's our governor with, you know, the president.
Right.
And you could see all the wetness behind his, you know, in his posterior. Okay. That was number one, not number two. Unfortunately, number two is what we got a lot of time on The Apprentice.
Oh, my God.
But, yeah, he's incontinent. And I don't say that to make fun of an old guy. I mean, that happens to people. I say it because it's a symptom of his drug addiction. And it's a sign of his unmanageability. And it's also something they're lying about because he hasn't submitted to a physical since 2018, February 2018.
Was that the Ronnie Jackson physical that we wondered about? And
that's
Ronnie Jackson, we find out now, I saw this today, is actually he's running for Congress from Texas as a Republican. He's obviously no longer the White House physician. And he's backing up Donald Trump. He's like, he's saying, oh, he's a great friend. He's a good guy. Don't, you know, and saying the Obama administration did everything that Trump says they did. And the Obama people are going, what the fuck? I mean, we were friendly with him. He wasn't political back then. He didn't do any of this stuff. Somehow Trump radicalized him, it sounds.
Which Trump does. You know, he appeals to these people like you can be powerful, you know, and Ronnie was his guy. His guy in New York City was, you know, Howard Bornstein, Bornstein. That was his doctor feel good in New York. And as soon as Trump got elected, he sent Keith Schiller and a couple other bodyguards to Harold's office and they knocked him aside and took all of Trump's medical records.
That's right.
That's a fact, you know? So he goes down to D.C. He meets another guy who's going to be loose with the script, so to speak. Ronnie already had a reputation of handing out at a van on White House flights and, you know, drinking his bourbon. But he went full Nazi the other night. If you saw his tweet, he was like, Obama should be like hauled before Congress and stuff. You know, he was completely parroting these fascist talking points. But Trump, that's his, you know, he's found a lot of venal guys in the modern GOP, you know, that are like, you can ride with me and we can run this place. That, I mean, that's what it is.
It's astounding. It's absolutely astounding. You mentioned Bornstein, this doctor who we remember the letter that Trump allegedly, you know, that the doctor wrote for him saying he's in the best health ever. He'd live to 200. Or maybe that was Ronnie who said he'd live to 200.
He would live to be 200 years old after the first White House physical. Right. Bornstein. He's the finest physical specimen to ever hold the office of president should he be elected.
Oh, my God.
And when we came to find out, Trump dictated it.
Yes. Right. Well, of course he did.
And Bornstein is a gastroenterologist. Trump made him his chief physician since the 80s. And he was known, I mean, on the Upper East Side, where I've lived for 20 years, he's Dr. Feelgood.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of, he's been sued multiple times for over prescribing, and people have OD'd and died, you know, Park Avenue housewives. You know, if you need a Xanax script or an Adderall script, he's the guy you go to. And that's a huge problem in the recovery community these days in the city.
I mean, no kidding. Right. So, but he's still practicing. I mean, this guy hasn't been called up by the medical board or anything.
Not that I know of. I know he was scared because he did speak out and he said, you know, basically they threatened my life. You know, he said,
oh,
I was terrified. And I know somebody privately who spoke with him because his office is still there and they ran into him and his wife. And he said, yeah, you know, they put the fear of God in me, which is another reason people don't speak out. Trump's a mobster, basically.
That's,
you know,
right.
People know that in New York. So, you know, so they're like, he's going to get away with it and I'm going to get killed, you know, basically.
Well, and
my career is.
Yeah. So, sorry. Noel Castler, I'm listening to you and thinking, why aren't you afraid? Aren't you scared that they're going to come after you?
I don't want them to come after me. And it's not that I'm not afraid. I'm more afraid of not speaking up and then having to live with myself afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I'm more afraid of a country that locks up kids in cages right now. You know,
tell me about
I'm
it.
More afraid of a country that's going to hide the death count from, you know, a global pandemic because it's going to hurt our leaders' reelection chances. So it's not about me anymore. This is about other generations. He's already gotten us into a hole that it's going to take us 20 years to climb out of economically
easily.
Socially and stuff.
Right.
So I'm afraid of, and here's what, here's a better way to put it. I'm more afraid of what happens if he gets reelected. I'm more afraid of what we are this time next year if he's not stopped, because you won't recognize this place.
No.
We barely recognize it now. And the thing with Trump is he does this stuff almost out in the open and he wears you down. And then you come to accept it. You know, on the Miss Universe pageants, the first year they shot it, when you're shooting a live TV show, it's very expensive, you know. So mm-hmm. you have cameramen and all these union guys standing around. So you can't waste 5 minutes. It'll cost you, you know, 10 grand. Trump came out, lined up all the girls and inspected them, walked up and down, stuck his finger in their mouth, checked their teeth, made little notes, looked at their asses and stuff.
Oh my God.
It took an hour. The ADs are sitting in the truck like, what's going on? Cameramen are sitting around. They went home, told their wives, like, this guy's a pig like you wouldn't believe, right? The next year, what happens? They show up to work. On the production schedule, there was an hour written in Trump inspects contestants. So they knew not to send the cameramen and everybody down to set so they could save production costs.
Oh, wow.
So that's an example of how he normalizes the abnormal. And people come to accept it because they're like, well, I don't want to ruin my life. I don't want to lose my job. And no one's going to stop him. And there's too much of that. Nobody stops him. And we end up, look where we are now.
Yeah.
I mean, he never should have gotten elected, you know?
Never in a million years. And I'm one of those people who said, oh, there's no way the Republicans are going to let him win. They're just not going to go there. Not only did they go there, but they bend over backwards to let him get away with this shit. He's destroying not only our country, but the planet. And now with this pandemic and his wonderful mismanagement of it, we're going to have probably hundreds of thousands of people dead due to his irresponsibility. So you're right. He never should have gotten elected. And we kept thinking someone's going to come forward. And Noel Castler, you're the guy. You're the only one who's spoken out. And again, let me go back to the NDA. So we know that everybody has to sign one. We know that Mark Burnett, who was the executive producer of The Apprentice, is a big, high-powered TV executive. By the way, he's not American. He's Australian, if I recall correctly.
English.
British. English. Okay. And not that that makes any difference, but I don't know.
It kind of does.
Right, because
he wanted to make The Apprentice about Putin first. You know, he went to Russia with that idea first, and he wanted to make it about a Russian oligarch who was close to Putin. And they told him, no, go to America and make it about Donald Trump. We got a guy in New York you need to make this show about. And Burnett created this image that people now see of Trump. Most of the country, like you and I, Nicole, I'm from New York. You know, I was in high school in the 80s. Trump was a joke.
Yes.
You know, he was Dick, he was Dick Lassay. He was, you know, he was the guy who sold condos so you didn't have to go in front of a co-op board anymore. So you could own a Russian poker den and get a nice place on Fifth Avenue. You know, you didn't have to go to Bryn Mawr. Like, he changed the game in a not a good way, and he was never accepted for that in New York. And you know the tabloid fodder he created on his own. So his image was revitalized by Mark Burnett. He was broke by the time The Apprentice started.
Right.
The first season they shot it, they had to rent the office furniture because the furniture in their actual office was so ratty that they were like, nobody's going to believe this guy's rich. Wow. So the production had to bring in rental furniture. That's how downbeaten the whole thing was. And he's not a functional guy. I mean, Trump spent his days looking through New York Post to see where, if he was mentioned in page six. He didn't have any crazy business acumen. He was a money launderer.
Yeah.
You know, he was basically paid to run businesses into the ground.
So yes. And again, he inherited all this money from his dad that, you know, he never had to pay back that. But he says, oh, I'm a self-made man. No, he's not. Yeah. And then then when he was called on it, you got $3 million. He said, well, that's not a lot of money. Hello.
Well, it was like $300 million.
Yeah, I know.
You know, $700 million total inheritance. And he lost it. He had lost that money by the time he did The Apprentice.
Right.
The Apprentice was the biggest paycheck he'd gotten since his father passed away.
Wow.
And his own father, on his deathbed, had to lawyer up because he knew Trump was going to make a run for his fortune and his other siblings were going to get screwed.
Oh, wow.
So his own father lawyered up against him. But yes, he ran every business into the ground. He bankrupted casinos. It's almost impossible to do that.
Right. No, you're right. The house doesn't ever lose. Trump lost and went up. So, but Mark Burnett. So there were all kinds of rumors about this tape, an outtake tape going around from The Apprentice of Trump being himself, saying racist things, doing what he does, what you witnessed. Tom Arnold did this whole big thing. He was going to find the tape. He knew it was there.
Right.
And the tape never materialized. Do you know if there's a tape?
I definitely, there's probably 1,400 hours of that stuff. There's definitely tapes. Whether they still exist, I would probably, I couldn't venture a certainty. My guess would be, since a judge recently ruled that MGM has to release the tapes, Mark Burnett owns MGM. The tapes are kept on a lot on MGM in a vault. I would guess that maybe digital files are, those hard drives,
yep,
might have found their way to some, you know, nefarious end at this point, just like the tapes in Jeffrey Epstein's cell.
Yeah.
Which is also why I'm speaking out. You probably won't hear what's on those tapes. His base is not going to care. It would play well with them. It's a copious use of the N-word. He was like he had Tourette's. He would walk around using that word in situations that you don't want to hear anybody use that word. As white people, unfortunately, we've all heard other white people use that word. At least I have. You know, I'm 49. He would use it like on set to describe the other contestants. And I've heard him use that word, and I tweet actual quotes that I remember, you know?
Yeah, I should mention, you've got an awesome Twitter stream. It's at Kassler, C-A-S-L-E-R, Noel, N-O-N-E-L. So your name just reversed, and people should follow you. And a lot of people do. You've got a ridiculous amount of followers, but you tweet all this stuff on a regular basis. And again, you've not heard anything from Mark Burnett or from Trump's attorneys saying stop.
And I tweet at him.
I know.
You know, I'm not trying to hide this. This is not an end around. I'm tweeting it directly at him. I've tweeted it at Mark Burnett. You know, it's the truth. What are you going to do about the truth? You know, I'm just a little comedian. You know, he's president of the United States. If he does sue me, you have discovery. You know, prove that I'm lying. You know, let me bring my friends who heard you say it in front of the world. He's not going to bother. And it's only going to help his case. You know, he's running on a platform of racism. Right,
yes,
now.
He is.
You know,
I agree.
But the tapes exist. Okay. But and people get very like, where are the tapes? If you think the tapes are going to bring him down, they won't. And I'm not saying we don't deserve the tapes. You heard the Access Hollywood tape.
Yes.
He said himself, I like to grab women by the P word. If you're rich, they let you do it.
Yep.
I moved on her like a bitch.
Yep.
Anybody else did that, their career would have been over. Gary Hart went on a boat ride with his mistress and it was over.
Exactly. Exactly. You know? And it should have been, and it would have been. But Donald Trump has this talent of saying, I'm going to deny everything, which is what he does. And I'm going to ignore it. And I'm going to say that's not true and just keep plowing through. And he does. And it's been successful for him. It's mind blowing how the American people can't see through this con man is just mind blowing. And here you are speaking out. Now, I think it's kind of a shame that you haven't been in interviewed by all the major TV networks, all the news operations, because you're saying things you personally witnessed, yet they're so afraid, I guess, of losing access that they won't cross him in that manner.
Yeah, I mean, there's some good people, obviously, you know, in network journalism. They don't want to become part of the story for the most part, and I believe they'd become a big part of it if they brought this stuff.
Oh, yeah.
The other thing, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. I was agreeing with you. Yeah.
And the other thing is these things sound so outrageous that people don't want to accept it. You know, addiction is something that blossoms in denial. If you have an alcoholic father, you know, and they get sober and go to, you know, Alcoholics Anonymous, the rest of the family should go to Al-Anon.
Yes.
It's a family disease because you get caught up in this cycle of codependency and you don't want to admit that daddy's really sick. And it's almost like as a nation now, we're all codependent children with a very sick father that nobody really wants to call out how bad it is. And it's plain as day. Forget about what I say. Look at his behavior in the last 2 months as president.
Yes.
At his press conferences, and tell me that's a human being that is functional and healthy and should be in charge of the future of the largest nation on earth. You know,
in no possible dream or nightmare is that the case. And the fact that he stood up there at a COVID, you know, White House briefing and said, inject disinfectant into your body. And people are still listening to him. It's just mind blowing. I hope everyone listens to what you're saying. Noel Kassler, you're doing an amazing public service. I hope you are being really careful. I hope there are people who check in on you constantly, because frankly, I'm worried. They may not say anything publicly to you, and that scares me, that he hasn't threatened you with a lawsuit. Please watch your back. I hope you carry mace or something with you regularly.
I'm all right. I'm hiding out. You know what I mean? It's not about me, Nicole. It's about like those kids in cages and those people sitting on ventilators and those people that don't even know any better at this point. You know, I'm trying to save them from themselves as much as anything else, you know?
Well, you're a hero and you deserve a medal, and we'll have to make one for you. Noel, thank you so much for joining us today. Like I said, I've known of you for about a year and a half now, and yeah, and I'm so thrilled you agreed to come on the show. These are things that everybody needs to hear, especially those who defend the madman. So thank you for speaking out and not being afraid.
Likewise, thanks for having me on and not being afraid. You're doing a service just by having me on that most people won't do. So I applaud you, Nicole, and a longtime fan. I know who you are, so keep up the good work.
Oh, wow. Well, thank you so much. And you're welcome anytime. Anytime you've got an open invitation. And I really, really appreciate it. So stay safe.
Thank you.
You know, on all fronts, stay safe from Trump and stay safe from the virus and take care of yourself. We need you.
Thank you, Nicole. All right. I appreciate it.
Thank you. You take care. I'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye. All right. And wow, that was just very cool. Thank you so much to Noel Castler.